A very good evening to all of you. I welcome you all to the ICAN initiative, the Hindu and Indian Express analysis. So we will start the day with the story of the two wolves. So once a grandfather told a story to his grandson. He says, my son, there is a battle between two wolves inside all of us. One of the wolves is an evil wolf, which represents anger, jealousy, greed, inferiority, ego. And the other wolf is a good wolf. It represents joy, peace, love, kindness, and truth. So the grandson asks, grandfather, which wolf will eventually win? The grandfather says that the one you feed will win. So this shows the power of your mind. Whatever thoughts you feed your mind, that's what will actually happen also eventually. On a lighter note, जब भी मैं अपनी स्कूल जाती थी और मैं लेट होती थी और मेरी क्लास टीचर पूछती थी क्यों नहीं आया, तो मैं उनको ऐसे ही बता देती थी कि मेरी माँ बीमार है, और इवेंचुअली मेरी माँ बीमार पड़ जाती थी. इवन इन कॉलेज आई यूज़ टू टेल कि मेरे गाड़ी पंचर हो गया, तो देन इट इवेंचुअली यूज़ टू गेट पंचर्ड, माई टायर वुड बी फ्लैट द नेक्स्ट डे. तो ऐसा होता है कि वट एवर वी थिंक विल एक्चुअली मैनिफेस्ट इट सेल्फ इन टू अ रियलिटी वन डे. सो यू हैव टू बी वेरी केयरफुल विथ योर थाट्स, दैट इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू हैव पॉजिटिव थाट्स. It is important to be optimistic always, see hope, have faith. So that is very important. So even as UPSC aspirants, if you believe that you have it in you to become an officer, you will eventually become one. But if you engross yourself with all the self-doubt, you will just remain with the self-doubt and you will never end up being the officer, and you will never end up being reaching your dream. So please ensure that you are always filled with lot of optimism, energy and enthusiasm and positivity, and also radiate the same in your surroundings. So with this, we'll start with the first topic of the day, which is about the Vizag gas leak. So pehle iski severity ko samajhte hain. So 11 people have died, and including a 6-year-old kid has died, and 350 people have been admitted to hospital. So now, which gas is responsible for this whole thing, for the disaster, is a styrene monomer gas. तो हुआ ये था कि the styrene monomer gas leak हो गया from a chemical plant of LG Polymers India. तो अब इसके health risk क्या है? Respiratory issues हो सकते हैं, eye irritation होता है, concentration problems होता है. So thereby you will end up having a slow reaction rate. So this is the brief about the severity and which gas was involved and what is its health impact. So now we will see ki aisa hua kyun, where were lapses lying. So why did it happen? And because we already saw that the styrene monomer gas leaked, and we already saw the health impact, that is respiratory issues, concentration problem, eye irritation and so on. But hardly any deaths have been reported till date. So there are also no studies which says that it could lead to death in severe cases. So now let's see the issues ki ye hua kyun. First thing is that the nature of the gas. Styrene monomer gas is a hazardous gas. So this is mentioned under the schedule of manufacture, storage and import of hazardous chemical rules of 1989. तो इस रूल के अंदर ये गैस मेंशन किया हुआ है दैट इट इज़ हजार्डस इन नेचर. सो व्हाई इट इज़ हजार्डस, बिकॉज इट हैज़ अ वेरी पुअर स्टेबिलिटी. इट इज़ स्टेबल व्हेन इट इज़ स्टोर्ड एट -20 डिग्री सेल्सियस और बिलो, बट जैसे ही टेम्परेचर राइज हुआ इट विल मूव फ्रॉम इट्स लिक्विड स्टेट इन टू गैशियस स्टेट. तो गैशियस स्टेट में प्रेशर बिल्डअप होता है और वो एक्सप्लोड हो जाता है. सो दिस इज़ वाई द गैस इज़ एक्सट्रीमली हजार्डस. द सेकेंड इशू with respect to this industrial disaster was the population density. The plant was located in an area where the population density was high, where the number of people residing was high. So obviously, whatever consequences it has, it will affect a lot of people. The second issue is the safety mechanism. So safety mechanism is very important. Whatever the incident, it shows that the safety storage system that has to be there for storing the hazardous gas was either faulty or it was overridden. So the safety aspect was compromised in this issue when it comes to storing the hazardous gas safely. So safety thoda compromised gaya tha. Fir the next issue is the apathy. हुआ ये कि द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट इन इंडस्ट्रीज दे ऑल न्यू दैट दिस गैस वॉज अ हैजार्डस नेचर गैस एंड द पॉपुलेशन वॉज रिसाइडिंग इन द विसिनिटी सो विच कुड बी वेरी डेंजरस इफ एंड वेन देर इज अ गैस लीक सो बट स्टिल देर वॉज नो एक्शन दैट वॉज टेकन एंड देर वॉज नो प्रिकॉशनरी मेजर्स दैट वर टेकन सो दिस शोज द एपेथी ऑफ द इंडस्ट्रीज एंड द गवर्नमेंट द नेक्स्ट इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट इज दैट देर वॉज नो एनवायरमेंटल क्लियरेंस इटसेल्फ So this particular company had expanded the production beyond the limits of the environmental clearance or it had even changed the product mix without even obtaining a prior environmental clearance. So this cast doubts over the environmental impact assessment. So if you read your GS3 syllabus, wahan pe specifically mentioned hai environmental impact assessment. So you can use this as a case study to show the failure of EIA. So there was no environmental clearance at all. So next is a flouting of laws. So in fact, there is a environmental relief fund, okay, which is a central fund that is set up under the Public Liability Insurance Act. So under the Public Liability Insurance Act, there is a fund called as Environment Relief Fund. तो इसमें पैसे होते हैं जिसे which is actually used for the immediate relief of the victims of the accidents in a chemical industry. But the study by Vidhi Center for Legal Policy उसने ये देखा कि इस फंड में 810 crores unutilized ऐसे ही है for the last 3 decades. So this huge amount of 810 crores, which was actually meant for providing immediate relief to the victims of the accidents, has remained unused for the last 3 decades. So this shows how the flouting of laws is also there. See now, I have told 5 points till now regarding what are all the loopholes. बट डेफिनेटली एग्जाम में कोई ऐसा स्पेसिफिक क्वेश्चन नहीं आएगा कि वॉट वर ऑल द इशूज और लूप होल्स इन्वॉल्व इन द वाइजैक गैस लीक देर वॉन्ट बी अ क्वेश्चन दैट स्पेसिफिक सो यू विल गेट अ क्वेश्चन सेइंग दैट देर हैव बीन अ राइज इन द इंडस्ट्रियल डिजास्टर्स इन द रिसेंट ईयर्स सो एनालाइज द रीजन्स फॉर द सेम दिस कुड बी योर क्वेश्चन सो इन विच केस यू हैव टू यूज दीज स्पेसिफिक इशूज एंड यू हैव टू जनरलाइज दैम फॉर एग्जाम्पल देर इज अ राइज इन द in industrial disasters because one many of these disasters are happening in those industries which are residing in areas of dense population two these industrial disasters have these industries were using some chemicals which were hazardous in nature so it depends upon the nature of the operation of industry it depends upon the location of the industry and the third is the safety mechanism which the industry has adopted was compromised fourth it was about the apathy of the stakeholders involved like the government the industry and fifth the environmental clearance that was not there and flouting of laws all these you have to generalize and write to make that answer more generalistic by giving this as an example so now let us see what should be done मान लीजिए एथिक्स के पेपर में कोई केस स्टडी ऐसा आ जाता है कि आपके डिस्ट्रिक्ट में इंडस्ट्रियल डिजास्टर हो गया देन व्हाट विल यू डू एज अ डिस्ट्रिक्ट कलेक्टर सो इन दैट केस यू हैव टू इनकॉर्पोरेट टू टाइप्स ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर्स वन इज द प्री डिजास्टर एंड देन इज अ पोस्ट डिजास्टर सो यू हैव टू टेल द स्टेप्स इन बोथ द केसेस वॉट यू विल डू एज इन द प्री डिजास्टर फेस एंड द पोस्ट डिजास्टर फेस एंड इफ द क्वेश्चन इज पर्टिकुलरली आस्किंग that the disaster has already occurred now what will you do as a district collector that is the question itself is specifically asking about the post disaster phase in that case you have to adopt two categories which is the short term measures and the long term measures to ab hum ye dekhte hain ki isme short term aur long term measures kya kya ho sakte hain in short term first thing that you will always do is to provide to the medical needs of those who have been grievously hurt and injured in the disaster So first is to cater to the medical needs, ensure that people are safe, deaths are not happening. So second, but unfortunately some deaths do happen, so you have to definitely provide compensation to the victims of the disaster. Third is, the disaster has now happened, but you will have to set up an inquiry to look into the lapses, that what were the loopholes that led to this disaster. So you will set up an inquiry to look into the lapses. Okay now the inquiry has been done and during the period of the inquiry definitely you will suspend the operations of the industry and then meanwhile some people are in the hospitals and then others have been evacuated for whom you have to provide rehabilitation you will do that and then this inquiry gets over and then you identify people who needs to be punished So therefore, responsibility, and they have to be made accountable for the lapses. So for instance, 304A of IPC, it talks about causing death by negligence, for which a maximum jail term of 2 years is prescribed. So then you will focus on the punishment, that is putting the people who are responsible for this thing behind the bars. So this are all the short-term measures. Then what is the long-term measures that you will undertake in the district so as to in the future prevent such disasters from happening, and also even when the disasters happen, some measures need a long-term planning. So then what are those measures that you will take? So first of all, in any kinds of disaster, for instance in this case a chemical disaster, there will be certain short-term health impacts, like immediately you might have headache, nausea, vomiting and all that. But in the long term, it may cause cancers also, you never know. But then when that cancer happens, you should know that this cancer happened because of that particular gas leak few years before. So that is why you have to have some studies for long-term implications to understand what will be the long-term impact. So in this case, for instance, several international safety literature has pointed out that styrene gas can cause cancer also. So accordingly, you will have to formulate the response. Okay, so you have to think about the long-term health impact, and then accordingly, you have to form a response plan. So the next thing you're going to focus upon is the occupational safety. So imagine if this gas were to leak when the industry was in full operation. So then the health and the lives of all the workers would have been compromised. So occupational safety is again very important, for which you need to develop standard operating procedures and standards, tough standards to ensure occupational safety. This has to be done. Thirdly, no matter what, there will definitely be industries which will produce these hazardous chemicals, right? So what we need is a transparent oversight, so that they know that somebody is watching them and they cannot afford any lapses on their part, and they have to ensure all the safety and all the precautions that they have to. So there has to be a transparent oversight on the operations of the industries. Next is about the environmental clearances. So in this case, as we saw that there were lapses in the environmental clearance, the industry was working without even an environmental clearance. So this procedure has to be streamlined, and the provisions will have to be made more stringent depending upon the hazardous nature of the chemical that is involved in the industry or whatever product it is producing. So environmental clearances will have to be streamlined, and it has to be made more stringent depending upon the nature of the industry. The next thing is that this is something that relates to a more higher level, because we need some reforms in the law itself. For instance, there is this liability, there is this Nuclear Liability Act. So what does Nuclear Liability Act says that whenever any industry causes some nuclear disaster, then it has to compensate the victims. But the present legal framework which is there for those disasters, for those industrial disasters, jisme nuclear ka angle nahi hai, aise mein kya hota hai ki the victims will have to go to the civil court. तो वहाँ पे एडजुडिकेशन होता है, एंड देन ओनली द विक्टिम्स विल गेट द कॉम्पनसेशन. बट वी नो वॉट इज़ द लिमिटेशन ऑफ द लीगल सिस्टम. इट टेक्स अ लॉट ऑफ टाइम टू गेट दैट कॉम्पनसेशन, गेट द जस्टिस, एंड इट विल जस्ट गो ऑन फॉर डिकेड्स. सो देयरफॉर इट इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी चेंज दिस लीगल फ्रेमवर्क, वेरिन इवन फॉर एन एनी इंडस्ट्रियल डिजास्टर विच डज नॉट इंक्लूड अ न्यूक्लियर डिजास्टर, इवन देन देर हैज़ टू बी क्लियरली स्पेसिफाइड इन द लेजिस्लेशन regarding the compensation to the victims by the industry involved. So ye ek legal regime mein humko change lana hai, that is also very important. And in fact this principle of strict liability was evolved by the Supreme Court in the year 1987 mein Supreme Court ne bola ki this strict liability principle has to be there, and the case was oleum gas leak case. So oleum gas leak case mein Supreme Court ne bola tha regarding the principle of strict liability even in the case of these normal industrial disasters which are not nuclear in nature. Okay, so even in that cases the liability is on the company to offer compensation to the victims. So this was laid down by the Supreme Court in the oleum gas leak case of 1987. So at the end of it, just remember the thumb rule that agar question aaye exam mein to usko kaise categorize karna hai, to pre disaster and post disaster karna hai, aur short term and long term karna hai. Pre disaster means preventive and post disaster is curative, And then after the disaster also, you have to take certain short-term measures and certain long-term measures. In the long-term measures, you will talk about some legislations and some rules and something that take a lot of time, and it involves interdisciplinary approach, because they are all those things which will take a long time. In short term, you will just tell about the immediate things which you will have to take care. So that we will come to the next topic, which is the e-courts or virtual courts. So when we talk about courts in general, court teen tarike ke hote hai. Ek to conventional hota hai, which we all know, and the second is the online courts. Online courts mein kya hota hai? Courts happen through video conferencing, where there are lawyers also, there are judges also, but just that they are sitting right at their homes and then they are doing it through a video conference. But then there's a third type of court, jisko hum virtual courts kehte hain. Virtual courts mein there are no judges, there are no lawyers, there's no litigant also. So computer will decide based on the inputs given by the litigant. So there are no lawyers, no judges, just I will give some input to a computer as a litigant, and based on my inputs the computer is going to decide. So these are the three types of courts in India. So abhi hum baat karte hain basically online courts ke bare mein. So what are all the issues with respect to the online courts? So the first thing is, there is unfamiliarity with the medium of communication. That means these lawyers will have to face the camera, all right. But when you imagine a hearing, you can see that body language, facial expressions, the tone, the tenor, they are all very important signals jo hum ignore nahi kar sakte hai. Lekin jab online courts ki baat kare to the lawyer will just have to sit in front of the computer and then make his arguments, which is not possible for the lawyer, because he is accustomed to using that body language and the tone and tenor, so which are all very important signals that cannot be captured in a video conferencing. But however, this is not a very big hurdle, and this thing can be developed and fine-tuned, of course, over a period of time. So this is one hesitation for the lawyers, and this is the one opposition that comes from the lawyer side. The second is that there is a technology problem as well. So online hearing means it requires the availability of bandwidth, and so that the bandwidth will enable the hearings to be more stable, and the bandwidth is also of adequate nature for the hearing. But several times the bandwidth availability is poor, the network connections are poor. In fact, ironically, during the hearing of restoration of 4G connections in Jammu and Kashmir, the network suddenly snapped. So it shows ki network ke problems hote hai, to online court hearings kaise ho sakte hai? That is a very important problem. The third thing is regarding the consultations. So we must have seen even in the movies that lawyer apne client se baat karte hai, judges aapas mein discuss karke kuch decide karte hai. Lekin online courts mein kya hota hai? This fair hearing is not possible in the online courts. How can, when something is happening online, when the court session is happening online, how can a lawyer consult his client who are remotely placed? Similarly, the several judges which comprise of the bench, let's say that it's a three judge bench, the three judges are in different places, so how do the judges consult each other? So that will be a problem. So consultation will be a problem. And the fourth thing is, the chairman of Bar Council of India, he has told that the one of the biggest concerns is that the 90% of the lawyers, they are not computer literate and they are not tech savvy. So this is another very important problem, that if you are planning to have some cases decided online, it's very important that the people who are involved, they must have some basic digital literacy and they must be tech savvy, so that they understand the processes and they don't see it as a hurdle, and rather they don't see that the procedure is more cumbersome, but rather more smooth and time saving. So this is very important. And however, if you see some of the successful examples, there was a virtual court that was set up in 2018 in Delhi. So this virtual court used to decide about the traffic offenses. So here, this virtual court of Delhi, which decides on traffic offenses, was found to be of a great success. So the daily footfalls in the court drastically reduced, and thousands of people were pleaded guilty, and even they paid the fine electronically without the involvement of any lawyer or a judge. So therefore, it is important that we upscale the system of virtual court to include other petty offences also. Like for example, delayed payment of local taxes or some compoundable offences, traffic offences, all of these can be decided through virtual courts. So this will definitely bring down the burden on the conventional courts. So this is about the online courts. Now we'll come to the third topic, which is the water and climate change. So why is it important? Firstly, we know that water and climate change are inextricably linked to each other. Bahut dono mein bahut zyada link hai. And this year's World Water Day, the theme itself was climate change. And so therefore, that makes it even more important as a topic also to be asked in mains as a question. So now we will discuss about this. So now we will see how climate change can impact the availability of water and how that in turn can impact the climate change. So now we already know that climate change is a well-established phenomenon that's already happening. So climate change ke wajah se there is rise in the temperature. Rise in the temperature means more evaporation, and the availability of water will reduce because of climate change. Jab water ki availability kam ho jati hai, lekin population keeps increasing, so obviously the demand for water will keep increasing. When demand for water keeps increasing, there will be more energy intensive water pumping, there will be more water transportation and treatment, ye sab zyada hoga kyunki demand zyada hai. So how will you will use more energy intensive processes to pump out water. So energy intensive water pumping and water treatment, all of that will be there. So this again will lead to the degradation of carbon sinks. Degradation of carbon sinks means what? Carbon sinks like oceans, wetlands, peatlands, they will all degrade. Now these carbon sinks means what? They are those places which can absorb carbon dioxide, like oceans, wetlands and peatlands. Now if carbon sinks undergo degradation, they will not be able to absorb carbon dioxide. There will be more carbon dioxide in the air, there will be more heat trapped, and therefore it again gives rise to more climate change. So this is one circular and cyclical process that shows how climate change and water are inextricably linked to one another. The second thing we also see that climate change will directly have an impact on the water cycle in the atmosphere. So that means this impact will affect both the availability of water and also it will impact the quality of water. So ab water cycle ke upar do tarike ke impact ho sakte hain. Ek to in the warmer areas and the other in the colder areas. What happens in the warmer areas? Every 1 Fahrenheit degree rise in the temperature will increase the moisture content in the atmosphere by 4%. So therefore moisture content in the atmosphere will increase. So therefore this will increase the precipitation also, and this will lead to more flooding. Aur colder area mein kya hoga? Every 1 degree Fahrenheit fall in the temperature will lead to a 4% fall in the moisture. Therefore there will be less precipitation, and therefore there will be drought. So those areas that get rain, they will get more rains, and those areas that don't get rain, they will further not get rain. So there will be this two opposite ends and two extremes will be there. On the other hand, there will be too much of flooding, and on the one hand there will be too much of drought. So both of which are harmful. And this shows how climate change can impact the water cycle, and that in turn shows the impact of climate change, that is too much precipitation or no precipitation at all. So then what do we do? Whenever you are writing any answer on climate change, there are two important keywords which you must use in your answers. One is adaptation and the other one is mitigation. So adaptation and mitigation measures are very important in climate change, and these two keywords must feature in your answer anywhere. Okay, so what measures have to do? What have we already done? India already has a national action plan for climate change, and this has 8 missions under it, and that includes a national mission on water also. So that is one thing which we've already done. Next, we need to recharge our tanks and we need to recharge our ponds which are dying out. These tanks and ponds have also been silting. So because of the silt accumulation in the bottom of the tanks and ponds, their water carrying capacity has reduced. So therefore we need to go for desiltation of them so that their water carrying capacity will increase. Then we need to protect our carbon sinks. like we need to protect our oceans, we need to stop a over-exploitation of the wetlands and peatlands. Then we have also come out with the climate smart agriculture, drought proofing of agriculture. So this climate smart agricultural initiatives are very important. For instance, increasing the water use efficiency through micro irrigation system like drip irrigation and sprinkler irrigation. Then we have to go for rainwater harvesting also. That again is very important. Then we also have to adopt some lifestyle changes, like we need to reduce, reuse and recycle. The 3R approach, reduce, reuse and recycle, is again very important to adapt and mitigate the harmful effect of climate change on water and vice versa. Okay, so this we'll come to the next topic, which is we will be talking about Vande Bharat mission. In the Vande Bharat mission, so many people, the Indians who have been stuck in various countries across the world, which has been hit by corona, are now being brought back to India through flights. This in your syllabus there is a topic called as the role of Indian diaspora. So in this we will be basically learning about what role the Indian diaspora elsewhere in the world is playing, and how India is also protecting the interests of the Indian diaspora, which is located worldwide. So this is one of the measures which you can write under this measures taken by India to protect its diaspora. So this is the Vande Bharat mission, which you can quote. So like this, over a period of time, when you come across several initiatives, keep writing them down. So at the end of the year, you will have several initiatives taken by India to safeguard the interests of diaspora, which you can quote as latest examples in your answer. So next, we'll be discussing yesterday's question. So the question was, is ethical hacking ethical? So सबसे पहले तो it is very difficult to predict कि ऐसा कोई question आ जाएगा, लेकिन अभी आ गया है तो you have to deal with it. So then how do you deal with it? You know what hacking is? So hacking, you can just make your own definition, saying that it's like an entry through the back door into someone's confidential, personal, sensitive, important information. So that is hacking. Then what is so ethical about it? Maybe because it is used for public interest, maybe because it is used to make the systems itself more robust. So that is why it becomes ethical. So ethical, whenever we say something which is not so ethical as ethical, that means it must involve some public interest, right? So you can define ethical hacking and through making your own definition. So now we can think why ethical hacking is ethical. First is because yesterday itself we learned about John Stuart Mill and his principle of utilitarianism, that is maximum pleasure for maximum number of people. We need to reduce the pain and we need to maximize the pleasure. So this is for a broader good. If ethical hacking is for a broader good, then under utilitarian approach, you can say that it is ethical because it will provide more pleasure to more number of people. The second is, many a times it is used as a measure of preparedness. That means if you have some cyber system and if you want to know what are all the loopholes in the system, is it robust or can it be hacked by hackers? So for that, you call ethical hackers and you ask them to hack the system to see where are all the vulnerabilities lying. And then you plug those loopholes so that tomorrow it cannot be hacked by real hackers. So it is in the kind of a security audit. So in the nature of security audit, because of this, you can say hacking, ethical hacking is ethical. And third is because more often than not, ethical hacking happens with a consent. So the real purpose of ethical hacking is to find out the loopholes and plug them. And this main purpose is never malicious, and it just aims to avoid the damage and disruption to the business. So it always, more often than not, is after the consent is taken only it is done. Fourth, it is performed by experts. So these experts, they understand the latest hacking tools and techniques, and they will perform their assessments to the highest technical, legal and ethical standards. Okay, these ethical hackers, they are professionals who follow their own professional code of ethics. So that's why you can say that they will never misuse their knowledge, and they will abide by their professional code of ethics. And next, also it is performed very transparently. So an ethical hacker will share the findings and he will also advise regarding the vulnerabilities, whatever he has come across, and stresses the importance that these vulnerabilities be addressed. So it is also transparent in a way. So because of these reasons, you can say that ethical hacking is in fact ethical. But however, it may not be all that ethical also, because after all, an ethical hacker is a human being and human's nature is not predictable at all. So if an ethical hacker is exposed to the vulnerability of an organization or an individual, he or she might misuse it later on, because you never know the human mentality, human mind, how it might turn when. And second reason is also that yesterday itself we were talking about the means and the ends. So here the end may be good. That end is we want to identify the loopholes and plug it. We want to make the cyber systems more robust. That end may be very genuine and ethical. But however, we are adopting a means which is not so ethical. Means adopted is not justified. As Gandhiji told, means are as important as the ends. So on that lines, you can say that it is not ethical. And sometimes ethical hacking is used by the hacker later on to instill fear, okay, to use that information, confidential information, to bargain with an organization, to secure any position within the organization. So all of these things are unethical, of course. And then it is many times it so happens that the ethical hacker hacks somebody to show off the knowledge. That again is not ethical, because it shows the wrong use of knowledge. So these things, that human nature is not predictable, the means versus end debate, if it is misused to say instill fear or to bargain for a position in an organization, or if it is just used to come to limelight, then it is not a good thing. Then you can say that it is not ethical. Okay. And also you can say that whenever ethical hacking also takes place, there needs to be more objectivity and more transparency, that why something is being hacked, for what purpose, till what duration, and after the purpose is served, the data that has been hacked has to be destroyed. And all these things are very important, and they must be ensured. So now we will see today's question. Analyze the impact of climate change on economy. तो इसमें इम्पॉर्टेंट ये है कि आपको सिर्फ इकोनॉमी पे जो असर पड़ता है क्लाइमेट चेंज का, वही एनालाइज करना है. क्लाइमेट चेंज इम्पैक्ट ऑन इकोनॉमी, ऑन सोसाइटी, ऑन एनवायरनमेंट, बी रेडी फॉर ऑल दीज एंगल्स, बिकॉज क्लाइमेट चेंज एज अ टॉपिक इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड इट्स इम्पैक्ट ऑन एनी स्फीयर कैन बी आस्ड, वेदर ऑन एनवायरनमेंट और इकोनॉमी और सोसाइटी और एग्रीकल्चर, टू बी स्पेसिफिक, ऑन एनीथिंग इट कैन बी आस्ड. सो बी रेडी विद दिस. Try to make a frame and write down the side headings, what all you will include in your answer. So that's it for today. And आज फ्राइडे है तो कल परसों नहीं रहेगा. काफ़ी सारे मैसेजेस आते हैं वीकेंड्स में कि कहाँ है वीडियो, आज अपलोड नहीं हुआ है, तो ये नहीं भूलिए. अभी सीधा हम मंडे को मिलेंगे. थैंक यू. बाय बाय.